So in terms of Dell, we are essentially a broad-based technology company now. In addition to desktops and notebooks, which we've been making now for more than 20 years, we're also a very significant player globally in areas like servers, storage, workstations, we're number one in the world storage. We are EMC's largest partner on the high end of storage, and depending on the low end of storage, we are number one or number three. In servers, we're number two around the world, et cetera. So we've got a very large, diversified set of products now that we offer around the world. And in terms of a company, we're about a $56 billion company now around the world with 65,000 employees. About 80% of our business comes from corporations, 20% come from consumers, and enterprise, which is servers and storage, now account for about 20% of the company. So we actually sell more than $10 billion worth of servers and storage around the world. APJ, or APAC, Asia Pacific and China, which India is a part of, is about 11% of the 56 billion, so call it about 6 billion. That was for the trailing four quarters. This year we'll do about $8 billion worth of revenue in Asia Pacific and China. And at the end I'll tell you how big India is for us and what our plans here are. So that's in a nutshell what you know, who we are and what we do. We have seven manufacturing locations around the world, and we will have a manufacturing plant here in India. We'll announce in the next 2 or 3 weeks the location for our manufacturing plant. We will actually start manufacturing all our products in India. So now moving to how we think about our customers and supply chain, what it means for us. First of all, I think when we think about our supply chain, we think about the supply chain starting with the customer all the way through to our smallest supplier, right? So we don't think about, so a lot of companies I know define supply chain as it's manufacturing back. We actually think about it as end-to-end supply chain. And then there are a couple of ways that we think about our customers that are very important to us. And I think as we get into this, I want to try to set the framework for that. The first one is we are direct in everything we do. So what that means is, let me start on the customer-facing side. We only deal directly with our customers. We don't work with retailers. We don't work with value-added resellers. We don't work with systems integrators, et cetera. So the relationship is direct between Dell and a customer, whether it's a corporate customer or a consumer. The second thing that's important is we have a notion that's called single point of accountability. What that means is for every one of your needs, whether it's a product that you buy, whether it's a bill that you're trying to, you know, order that we're trying to process, whether it's a billing question that you have, or whether it's a service and support for your product, Dell is responsible for all of that, right? So it's closely tied to essentially our direct model where we work directly with our customers, where we believe in single point of accountability. So for instance, if something goes wrong with your product or your service, we have nobody else to blame. You essentially can only blame us. And we think that's a pretty powerful powerful notion that we believe strongly in. The third part of this, the Dell model that's important, is build to order. So our supply chain is entirely geared around build to order. So what that means is we will not manufacture a product, be it a notebook, a desktop, or a server, until we get an order. And that product is actually manufactured to your configuration. So let's say you want a specific type of notebook and you want to define how much memory you want in it, whether you want a CD-ROM drive or not, define, you know, how big you want your screen. That specific one unit doesn't get assembled or manufactured until we get the order from you. So we don't make anything to inventory as a whole company. And then finally, we believe in and we only develop and deploy products that are industry standards based. So we don't believe in proprietary hardware technology. So all our technology is based on industry standards, and that does several things for us. Most importantly, we believe that it enables us to offer very compelling solutions to our customers that are best value, best products at best value, right? So we are industry standards based. So when we want to buy even a component, we go directly to that component manufacturer and actually deal directly with them. Single point of accountability, build to order, et cetera. So that then, how does that translate to how we think about our supply chain broadly? It translates to several ways in which we think about our business that are somewhat different to how other manufacturers think about their business, right? Firstly, we believe that inventory is really bad. So, you know, inventory is bad because of the cost, but more importantly, inventory is bad because it reduces our ability to respond fast to our customers, right? So instead of inventory, we tend to think about information, and you'll get a better feel for what I'm talking about as we go through this. Physical assets. Dell's return on capital was 65%. We don't own anything, right? We believe in not owning assets. We don't own a single building around the world. And I'll tell you about the working capital that we own. So we basically don't believe in physical assets. And all the investments that we make, we try to make into what we call intellectual assets, which for us, which is really people, right? Third, you know, we don't believe in closed supply chains, closed networks, because we believe that it reduces speed, it reduces the pace of innovation, et cetera, and we believe in massive levels of collaboration. So if you look at how we actually build our supply chain, how we do R&D, how we bring products to market, we believe in leveraging the best that other companies have to offer as opposed to doing everything ourselves, which then ties to the last point, which is vertical integration. We actually believe in what we call virtual integration, and I'll talk to you what that means in a sense. So if you think about a company, one company that actually owns a lot of what they do, right, different parts of the value chain or the business system, we believe that you don't need to own most of what most companies own. But we believe, though, that integration is very important, but virtual integration, which is having multiple entities that operate like one company interconnected through technology and processes, is what makes, what's very important. So now let's get into some specifics. So in terms of the, what we call virtual integration, right? So let me start on the left-hand side of the slide here, which is the traditional model. Traditional model, you have a supplier, they deliver product to a manufacturing plant, product gets made, you get to a regional warehouse, local dealer, distributor, and then get to the customer, right? Most manufacturing companies, I think those of you in manufacturing businesses, probably have between 40 to 90 days worth of inventory. So that, we think of that as a traditional model where essentially you're manufacturing to forecast. So at Dell, with the Dell Direct model, number one, we don't manufacture to forecast. We don't actually manufacture a product, not even a single product, until that product is ordered by a customer. And once the order is placed, within minutes, we actually send electronic messages to all our suppliers who supply components for that product. Those suppliers actually deliver those parts to our manufacturing plant, and within 48 hours, we assemble that product. And from the manufacturing plant, the product is shipped directly to a customer. Now, in India, until we had the local India plant, we actually shipped it to the airport, and from the airport, it goes to the customer. So this then takes out three or four layers of the supply chain where, you know, we don't have regional warehouses, we don't work with dealers and distributors, we don't have local warehouses. We are a $56 billion company that has 4 to 5 days of total inventory. That's all we have, 4 to 5 days. And our stretch target is to get inventory down to 2.5 days. Right? And the reason we can do that is because we're built to order. We don't have any of these middle layers. And we only manufacture a product once we have an order. In 1991, which was 15 years ago, we had north of 60 days of inventory. So at any given time, you would have 60 days of inventory. Today, as I said, we have 4 to 5 days of inventory. Most of the time, we're running at about four. I think our average around the world is about 4.1 days of inventory. In our industry, every competitor has significantly reduced their inventory over a period of time, but you can see where Dell is today, right? It's substantially below 5 days, and we're driving towards getting that number more like 2.5 to 3 days. So in terms of how we make the entire business model work, right? So it starts with the customer placing an order. So we would, let's say if you're a corporate customer, we would have our salespeople, sales executives actually work with our customers. And we have field sales executives here in India, all over in all the big cities. They would actually take the order. So you have three options as a Dell customer to order a PC or a server or 1,000 servers, what have you. You can place an order, with a sales executive. If you're a corporate, large corporate company, we have field sales executives, right? They take the order. You can also call in, and you can order a product. Or outside of India today, you can actually go online, you can configure your product, and you can order it, right? In India, we're about 2 months away from being able to sell online. Today, you can go to the Dell website, you can configure your product, but you have to do the transaction, what I call offline. Depending on what time it is during the day, that order is either sent to our manufacturing, everything that we sell in India, and I'm going to make it somewhat specific to India, everything that we sell in India is manufactured in Penang, Malaysia today. It'll be manufactured in India, very soon. Either later today or tomorrow morning, that order is actually, that specific one unit, if it's one unit or if it's 1,000 servers, is manufactured in Penang, Malaysia, either this evening or tomorrow morning. Depends on what time in the morning we get the order. And it takes us 4 minutes to convert start to finish. To make a notebook, from the time a notebook starts in the factory, from the time it actually hits a truck to be shipped off to the airport, is 4 minutes. Now, so that's the front end of the supply chain, right? So obviously, there's a huge amount of technology and processes that we have in place to be able to do that. But one of the benefits of this direct relationship, the built-to-order model and the response time, is I can change my prices as many times a day as I want. Obviously, you know, if I've already quoted a price to you, I won't come and change your price, right? But think about in the U.S., you know, we have now a $9 billion U.S. consumer business, which means that's, you know, selling to U.S. consumers. And in the U.S., we change our prices several times a day. So because of this direct relationship and this incredible supply chain, right, we can change our price. So let's say, you know, one of my promotions is not working. You know, I've advertised a $799 desktop or notebook product. Increasingly, it's notebook, desktop are being, you know, promotion for $400. And let's say I find out that my promotion is working better than I thought, which means instead of having 1,000 units or 2,000 units, now I have 1,500 units that have already been booked. What I can do in the next 2 hours is I can actually take the promotion out. Because it's all direct. I have no product in the channel. I have no channel that's selling my product. So the front end of this supply chain is extremely agile, right? So I know you probably find this hard to believe, but on a $10 billion business, I can change pricing 20 times a day in my U.S. consumer business. And I can do that because of this direct relationship that we have with our customers, as well as the direct communication channel that we have. Then on the supply, on the other end, so now that's the, you know, the customer facing end, if you will. On the other end, which is with our suppliers, the minute we actually book an order, which is the order comes from the sales team, or you call in and we actually enter the order and it's pressed done, entered, right? That very second, our suppliers of every single component that sells a product or component that goes into that specific unit, whether it's a notebook, a server, a storage product, are actually informed and they know that a product is being ordered by Dell. And then they're responsible for making sure that they get the product to a Dell factory, usually the next day, at most 2 days from then, right? So that's on the that's on the supply chain of the house. And I'll talk to you a little bit about the type of technology that we use, type of supply chain processes that we use to actually do that. But hopefully you're getting a sense for how this supply chain works. Now, in terms of this type of supply chain or this business model called build to order, it's extremely important, and we believe, in a business like the high-tech business or the PC business, where component prices decline by 4 to 6% every quarter, and that's the best case, meaning that's the worst case for us. Usually it actually comes down faster than that, right? So what does that mean? So let's take a 30-month period. There are many months where if you look at it, let's say, look at July 1st versus July 30th. Look at a specific component. And let's say the price was $100 on July 1st. On July 31st, the price actually could be $96. $4 price drop, 4% in 1 month. There are components that actually decline that way. So now so let's assume that you ordered a product yesterday. The component price for that product that you ordered from Dell yesterday, the component price that we get is the price this week. The price this week, let's say, is 4% lower than the price for that component a month ago. So if I was building to inventory, I would actually get a 4 to 5% higher price on my component than if I actually order that component today. And it's a characteristic of high-tech businesses, right, where component pricing just keeps coming down. So because we actually don't carry in inventory, because we don't buy to a forecast per se, meaning I don't buy inventory, you know, I don't buy components 4 or 5 weeks ahead of time, and component pricing is coming down very rapidly every week, every day, I get a significant cost advantage towards that. About half of the cost advantage that Dell as a company has in the PC business globally comes from this factor. The fact that commodity or component prices decline every day, every week, every month, every quarter, and we carry no inventory. Therefore, we actually have the best pricing at any given point in time in a declining commodity environment. Now, there are, for those of you who are from the high-tech business, there are periods of time when component prices go up, like storage. You know, last year there were several months where memory prices actually went, you know, were out of control, they were going up. When component prices go up, this model works against us, right? So because essentially that means, okay, instead of buying it for $100 today, it's going to cost me $110 2 weeks from now. So when component prices are going up, which is very unusual, but it does happen in the high-tech business, this model works against us. But when the component prices are coming down, the model works in our favor. The other thing that also it lets us do is this sort of build-to-order model, if you will. It ensures that we can be much more responsive to our customers. And it also ensures that we are the fastest to bring to market new technologies, right? So Intel just launched a new set of processors. We don't carry any inventory. So Intel decides, starting Monday, they're going to launch a new processor. But Monday, you can buy Dell products with a new processor because we didn't buy any old processors. Whereas with traditional manufacturing companies, you know, if you had a traditional build-to-forecast model, you've now got a month's worth of old processors that you actually have to go sell. And so therefore, you're going to discount like crazy. Whereas we, at the minute that there's a new component in the marketplace, because we don't carry any inventory, we can actually bring that to market. Obviously, from a product development standpoint, we're working with those new processors for some period of time. So now, so that's on the supply side and on the customer side. So now let me talk a little bit about the characteristics of the type of suppliers that you work with, right? So you can't actually implement this business model with any supplier. Because as you can imagine, the demands, the technological sophistication, the internal processes, and the execution capabilities of the suppliers matters a huge amount to be able to pull off this business model, right? So from a supplier standpoint, one is, you know, we worry a lot about continuity of supply, right? Because we don't carry any inventory, we can't get into a position where we stock out of any component. So we spend an enormous amount of time really understanding our suppliers' business models and our suppliers' value chains and their supply chain capabilities to make sure that there is zero probability of stock out. Because I want to know if, let's say, you're providing monitors to me. I want to know whether you're going to run out of monitors. So I can actually tell you today, Samsung, what's in Samsung's business model from a monitor standpoint? We use technology extensively, obviously, especially collaboration technology. And I'll share one or two examples with you. We generally tend to partner with companies that are very sophisticated in applying technology to their businesses, right? Because that's the only way to get this whole thing to work. And finally, we have a great fondness towards companies that are low-cost manufacturers. We actually use RosettaNet. I don't know how many of you are familiar with RosettaNet. It's an industry standard collaboration platform that was developed about 6-7 years ago. Dell was a key part of developing that, but it was all our competitors developed that. And we use RosettaNet essentially as the underlying platform, collaboration platform, to collaborate across the board, across our supply chain, right? And we've developed a whole set of applications and processes and methodologies to be able to do that. Those of you who are interested, we can spend a lot more time on that. So that's on the how we collaborate. In terms of this continuity of supply, I mean, this is pretty important, right? Those of you who know, if you don't carry any inventory and we get an order today and I got to make the product tomorrow, continuity of supply is like hugely important. And there's several things that we do to ensure continuity of supply. The first, and some of these I think are somewhat unique based on what we've understood, some are probably not unique. Firstly, we have separate internal organizations that manage different parts of the procurement chain, if you will, right? We have a team called Worldwide Procurement that worries about strategic commodity categories and worries about supply that is, let's say, more than a week long. So a week for us, by the way, is a huge time frame, right? A day is like a big deal, so a week. And then we have regional materials operations teams that worry about 3 to 4 days, right? So basically, think about it, Worldwide Procurement, or procurement, you know what we call Worldwide Procurement, it's one team. Think about it as a team that worries about continuity of supply 7+ days. Then we have a regional ops team that focuses on 3 to solid 7 days. And then the manufacturing plants themselves have specialized supply chain teams that worry and work on the 0 to 3 day time frame, right? And then all of this is supported through a whole set of internal processes, et cetera. But in terms of our operations or our manufacturing model, there are a couple of things that are important, right? So in terms of our own manufacturing, we build to order. So what that means is multiple times a day. So if you go to a factory that we have in Penang, Malaysia, it's the closest factory that we have here. On average, if we have a, call it a 18-hour shift, we will have suppliers bringing components to that plant 12 to 15 times a day. Because, you know, they come in, deliver the plant, they go back, etc. So that's how we operate on our end. And then our suppliers, we give them a 1 to 2 week estimation of what it might be. Now, the other thing that our suppliers obviously have is all of you come from forecasting worlds, et cetera. They also apply all kinds of forecasting methodologies, etc. So our end, we have a pull model, and their end, they have sort of a push model, right? I'd say about half our suppliers around the world also have build-to-order models now. So it's pretty rapid. And also, when you go to a Dell manufacturing plant location, what you'll see is many of our suppliers are actually co-located right around that area. It's one big kind of ecosystem that works in a build-to-order fashion. We tend to stick to our core competencies. So we do a few things within Dell, and we do them extremely, extremely well. So we tend to leverage our partners extensively, right? So if we think that it's absolutely not a core competence, we would much rather have our partners do them, but then using technology and process really creates sort of a virtual enterprise idea. We worry a lot about time, if you can imagine, you know, the discussion we've just had. And we also try very hard in every part of our supply chain to simplify complexity. So at Dell, we talk about something called Easy as Dell. You know, everything needs to be easy. If you want a quote, I should be able to turn around a quote in 1 or 2 hours. Whether it's one unit, whether it's 1,000 units, whether it's 1,000,000 units, I got to turn it around in 1 or 2 hours. So we've worked very hard over time on all our processes to simplify that. And finally, as many of you know, it's really not about technology; it's about people and process. So we spend an enormous amount of time making sure we have the right people in the right places, and also re-engineering processes to continuously improve on our ability to respond to customers. Make sure our partners are successful, et cetera. So that's Dell globally. In terms of Dell India, we have been selling directly in India since 2001. Last year, we did our revenues in India from our India business was over 1,000 crores, and this year, at a minimum, we will grow 50%. We'll probably grow, if we grow only 50%, I won't be here next time I talk to you guys, which is in classic Dell fashion. So our aspiration is to grow much faster than that. Our focus over the last 4 or 5 years has squarely been on very large businesses, so companies over 1,500 employees. Last quarter, among very large companies in India, we were number 2. We are neck and neck. We're about 1.5 points below behind HP. And over the last 4 quarters, we have gained 10 share points among the very large businesses. Our focus going forward over the next 3 to 5 years is to actually expand beyond very large corporates and get into the middle market, get into small businesses. And we have a very simple goal, which is we want to be number 1 in corporate India in a 3 to 5 year time frame. That's not to say we won't sell to consumers. We will sell to consumers, but our big focus really is around becoming the preferred technology hardware partner for corporations in India, large corporations, medium-sized companies, and small businesses. And we have a reasonably straightforward game plan in terms of how we're going to get there. The first is expanding across all corporate segments. So today, as I said, we're basically a large corporate company. So we're doing a number of things to get into the middle market, accelerate our business in the middle market, accelerate our business in the small business, and we're also going to enter the government segment, which we haven't really played in so far. So in about 3 months, we will have a very aggressive push towards the government segment. Because we're a direct company, we don't work with channels. So the only way we grow revenues and acquire new customers is by adding Salesforce, right? Over the last 3 quarters, we've doubled our Salesforce in India. Over the next 2 quarters, we'll double again. And every 2 to 3 quarters, we will double our Salesforce here in India. And I spend about 30% of my time making sure we have the right sales teams in place, we have the right sales leadership in place, et cetera. Third priority is what we call winning the enterprise. Globally, we are number 2 in servers. In India, we are number 4. Globally, we have market-leading positions in storage, depending on what type of storage it is. In India, we are virtually non-player in storage. So the third priority for us is really accelerate our growth in servers, storage, and related solutions. Fourth priority is obviously India manufacturing. That's very important for many reasons, one of them being dramatically reduce our cost structure. And finally, we want to expand our service and support network. Today, we can do 4-hour on-site support 24/7 in the 8 metros in India, the Tier 1 8 metros in India. And we can do next business day support in about 350 cities. We're going to take our 4-hour on-site 24/7 support, we're going to expand that to about 20, 25 cities. And we're going to take our next business day support from 350 cities to about 1,000 cities. So that's the five-part game plan that we have.